Welcome, traveler, to the Archive. We are glad you have chosen to join us. Here you can find histories previously unknown, stories yet unlived, myths and legends beyond imagination. Enter these halls with a spirit of exploration, of discovery, and you shall leave with the greatest treasure one could imagine. If you seek some certain knowledge, a secret most dire or knowledge most rare, petition the Chronologue. They who listen to the voices of the universe, petition them humbly, for they hear a million voices, and each clamoring for new wonders, new delights, new challenges. Welcome to the Archive. We have been waiting for you.
Hang you my bandage,
if you make yourself more than just a man, if you devote yourself to an idea,
bandage,
and if they can't stop you, then you become something else entirely.
Bandage,
hello there, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Mildra, and I will be your gaming monk for the evening. Let's talk about modularity. It's the dream of many a game to accompany multiple playstyles, be it heavy on crunch, narrative, combat, social, what have you. However, there's often a kind of spinning plates issue if this is not handled appropriately. Even if they do, ultimately one playstyle will reign supreme in terms of developer focus. That's not a commentary on people's abilities, it's just the way the mind works. When I covered the Alien RPG a while back, I mentioned that I was billed on the game having two styles in cinematic and campaign. While that mainly reflected the style of adventure, the idea of two sub-mechanics is one that's largely untapped, with the biggest example being Final Fantasy Seed, the game I didn't cover during Final Fantasy Week. This brings us to Emberwind, a game that operates in two styles leaning towards narrative and crunch in a mix-and-match format through character creation, core mechanics, and randomization mediums, theoretically allowing players and GMs to personalize the experience for their table. How does it hold up? Let's find out. Emberwind runs at a very light 120 pages as far as its hero manual goes, accompanied by a 128 campaign book called The Skies of Axia. It carries itself with a motif akin to a board game manual in terms of its presentation. The game has a very striking visual style, with an emphasis on paintbrush motifs. Very reminiscent of the art style in Guild Wars 2 in a weird way. Now this adds to the light approach to the book's design, making it a pretty easy read with no shortage of color. Unfortunately, there is a distinct lack of an index. The digital version has a well-defined set of bookmarks, but my policy still has to apply. Character creation takes place in one of two forms, aspect or attribute. We'll be exploring both with two different characters, the first being Sardas Teselart, who will be in the Tactician class. More on that later. Now, after selecting our concept and class, we have to select our starting tier, akin to the power level that ranges from Tier 1 to Tier 4. Tier 1 are fresh-faced adventurers, Tier 2 are proven adventurers, Tier 3 are seasoned adventurers, and Tier 4 are known for their legendary exploits. We'll go with Tier 1 in our case and gain the basic values from it as seen in the chart here. This means that we start with 20 HP, 4 to all defense and barrier values, 8 to all skills, 1 to all special action limits, 2 tide turner charges, 1 5 square move actions, 1 square shift action, 2 to critical, 10 to accuracy, and 5 to penetration. Step 3 is aspects. Essentially, these are meta tags that affect the character's core stats and improve with character tier. Aspects are categorized into offense, defense, and utility. We may select one from each. In our case, we'll go with precise for offensive, tough for defensive, and dynamic for utility. This combination grants us the following benefits: +2 accuracy, HP, and toughness, +1 willpower, and +1 trigger limit. Step 4 is skills, occupations, and maneuvers. This can be done on an individual basis or a concept basis. We'll be going with the latter here. This means that we select one occupation and one maneuver. Our choice of occupation will grant a +6 modifier to one skill and a +4 modifier to 3 other skills. Now in our case, we'll go with Skirmisher, with Athletics as our major skill and Stealth, Leadership, and Insight as minor skills. The other half of this, of course, is maneuvers, a specialized action that relies on the use of a skill. In our case, we'll go with vault, which is tied to the athletics skill. Step 5 is equipment, wherein we can choose our starting melee weapon, offhand and ranged weapon, as well as our starting armor. In our case, we'll go with a one-handed sword, a heavy shield, throwing knives, and heavy armor. This also means that we gain +2 to accuracy, +1 to resistance, and our first basic ranged attack being treated as a fast action. Step 6 is class actions, the features and abilities that the class brings to the table. We can choose 6 actions and or traits, and 2 tide turner abilities, which require the use of a charge. The abilities we have access to are from the class's tier 1 list of each. We'll go with Insightful Leader, Valiant Strike, Battlefield Tempo, Settle the Score, Leader's Comfort, and Two-Pronged Attack for our class actions, as well as Inspire Greatness and Triumphant Return for our Tide Turner actions. The final step is Anchors and Keepsakes, a narrative personalization for the character. First is Anchor, representing people, places, and things valued by the player. Anchors are point-based, and we have 6 points to spend on them. In our case, we'll go with Astrology, the Captain of the Guard, and Falconry. The other half, Keepsakes, are special items that have significance to the character, which can grant a limited use benefit. In our case, we'll have a scroll that he always keeps on his person. Before I get into my thoughts on character creation, we're going to be doing this again using the attribute creation system, obviously with a different kind of character. Attribute-based character creation is a little more traditional than aspect. We'll explore this with an ardent named Janus Sørensen. First comes tier. Much like before, we'll be doing tier 1. However, we won't be using the starting traits like we did before. Instead, we have an alternate starting setup of 10 HP, 2 to defense and barrier values, 5 to all skills, 1 to all limits, 1 4-square move action, a 1-square shift action, 8 accuracy, and 1 penetration. The next step is where attributes are determined, instead of using aspects as we did before. Attributes are generated by rolling 3d4 and dropping the lowest 4 times. Our rolls in this are 7, 6, 5, and 5 to assign to the 4 attributes, along with 2 free points. In our case, after putting in the 2 free points, we have Intelligence 8, Resilience 7, Strength 5, and Dexterity 5, which grants us the following benefits. 12 HP, 6 Penetration, 4 Resistance, Insight, Knowledge, and Mend, 3 to Willpower, Fast Talk, Focus, and Leadership, 2 to Toughness, Athletics, Endurance, and Intimidate, +1 Critical, +2 Tide Turner Charges, and +2 Damage, and +1 to Amplify and Trigger Limits. The next step is Skills and Maneuvers. This time around, we'll forego occupations and choose Major and Minor Skills manually, going with Insight as our major and Focus, Knowledge, and Intimidate for our minor skills. For Maneuver, we'll go with Analyze. Next is Equipment, which works the same way as it did before, and in our case we'll go with a Scepter, a Wand, a Foci, and Robes. Next are Class Actions, which works the same as before, and in this case we'll go with Spark, Soul Strike, Raging Inferno, Hearth's Glow, False Camaraderie, and Mana Shield for our Class Actions, and Composite Magic and Shatterstorm as our Tide Turner actions. Character creation is fascinating, and in a way reminds me of 13th Age's design, due to its emphasis on having tiers possess a significant feel at individual tiers here. In addition, the use of 2 character creation methods is a very wise move and is handled pretty naturally, since the aspect system allows for people to develop based on broad concepts with a balanced approach, whereas the attribute system is for those who wish to be far more hands-on. It also avoids the trap of having certain more or less complex setups, since each has sets of abilities that allow them to contribute. That said, I could see some taking issue with the overall spread of abilities and the de-emphasis on equipment, especially if they're used to more traditional leveling methods. That, however, is the nitpickiest of the nitpicky. Emberwind uses the Rise system. Like character creation, the Rise system is a modular design with not necessarily one core resolution system, but rather 2 for role-playing and 2 for combat. The first pair, for role-playing, is mostly the use of player skills. Now, in option A, you have the dice rolling method, being a roll under d20 system wherein the skill rating is the number you have to shoot for. The second method is the Deck of Fates, a 52-card deck of success and failure cards. The GM adds success cards based on the skill rating of the character, and then adds failure cards until the total deck is 20, adding additional cards based on the situational modifiers. Then the player draws one card to determine success or failure. Situational advantages or disadvantages allow for multiple rolls or draws, respectively. Combat takes place in one of two forms, skirmish and war, with the difference between the two being scale. I should note that Emberwind does not use a roll initiative setup. Instead, it has an initiative slot, alternating between heroes and escalating tiers of foes, grunt, awakened, elite, and boss. Between rounds, participants can opt to swap slots in the initiative order. Actions are on a point-based approach, with heroes having 4 action points each turn that can be used on slow, fast, and free actions. Slow ones cost 2 points, fast ones cost 1, and free actions are, well, free. Now, further limitation on actions is the trinity of trigger, sustain, and amplify effects. For each of these, there's a set number of times that those effects can be used per round. Lastly, the act of attacking is rooted in what's known as the cap check. Cap is shorthand for critical, penetration, and accuracy. This is a degree of effect system using one d20 roll to determine if you hit or if the target can defend. At the bare minimum, you need to roll under accuracy to land a hit. If you roll under penetration, then the attack ignores damage reduction. If you roll under critical, it's a critical hit that deals maximum damage. Foes operate under a slightly different set of actions. Foes possess an AI hex grid, which is rolled to determine the foe's move and action chain, with higher tier foes having larger grids and bosses having red hexes that act as locked actions which slowly unlock during an encounter. It should be noted that unlike player characters, foes do not roll a cap check. Instead, they roll against the PC's defense value, with the damage being reduced by an appropriate barrier value. This is a system rife with potential for those who like to hack, but the lack of a bestiary holds it back to a degree. That said, I could see some not caring for the AI motif with foes, feeling that it removes control from the DM. I'd counter that it allows for the possibility of a GM-less play being a bit more viable here than otherwise. However, it's clear that tactical combat is favored in this instance. The reason I didn't extensively cover the war part of combat is it doesn't quite act as its own system the way games like Legend of the Five Rings or Exalted have large-scale combat. At least at the time of this recording, due to the game's active development design, so I could be eating crow in 6 months. There are two prevailing thoughts I have about Emberwind. The first is that of a better version of Strike, while the second is a happy medium between 13th Age and Dungeon World. However, despite the large potential within the game, the sandbox it possesses is relatively small in comparison. I say this because Emberwind's emphasis on epics and four-tier formats will take some getting used to for people who are used to a constant stream of tangible advancement. This is where the active development part comes in. It's gradually being iterated and expanded upon by the developers based on the potential here. But it makes things a bit inflexible. This is clearly a game meant for one-shots to medium-sized adventures instead of long-form campaigns, and it doesn't exactly have a sandbox yet to measure the foe systems against. It's for these and other reasons that the highest grade I can give Emberwind is recommended. There's a lot of potential here, but what stops me from fully getting in bed with the game's modular design is the lack of a true sandbox for GMs to build around. If nothing else, I feel this game needs a lot more examples of foes than are currently available. At the very least, a full-on bestiary to help GMs get over the hump. We'll see if that plays out, as I'm sure to be dipping into this pond once again in due time.